We have a video with Dalton Academy. Let's take a look.
And I would argue we're the only school in the world with a space engineer. And this student was teaching other students about rocketry and aerospace engineering and the designs of rocket ship.
But here, you get to choose what you want, and sort of like in that process, you will like discover what you want to do. And after you've discovered that, you can sort of cultivate yourself.
After our extensive discussion in the studio, it makes perfect sense for us to visit Dalton Academy. Said to be ahead of the curve when it comes to educational approaches, let's go meet the superintendent of the academy, Spencer Fowler, to learn more about it. Hello, Spencer. Thank you for joining us today.
No, thank you for having me.
So Spencer, we live in a technology-saturated society where we are surrounded by all these new technologies like AI, machine learning, you know, new educational softwares, and it's really shaking up the roles of educators and also transforming the way we teach, transforming the way we learn. What's your perspective about this? What do you think is the future of education?
I think the future of education needs to be more collaborative. Right now we have educators who studied education and they sort of try to protect or prevent others from joining a dialogue to then discuss the type of education that we need to have in the future. And the other issue is that most educators, you know, they're not specialists. And in the sense that how can they connect the teaching and learning to technologies and things that they have no idea about, right? So we don't have people who are generally engineers and people from the tech background within education. And likewise, then people who are in this world, in this industry, don't have the education background. And so they're not speaking the same language. And so there's a disconnect. And what needs to happen is that more students and teachers have an opportunity to work with and collaborate these people. And I think that oftentimes, as things are moving and spinning so quickly, we're trying to catch up, we're trying to chase something that we won't be able to. I think we need to look at education technology in a different way.
And in Dalton Academy, how are we bridging this gap between, you said, engineers and teachers? How are we bridging this gap and to bring students a better experience, learning experience?
Because we don't look to hire, I mean, anyone can be an educator. So we're not looking to hire people with traditional educator credentials. We have a space engineer, we have chemical engineers, we have people from differing backgrounds. We want people with life experience, industry experience, that will be able to immerse or introduce our students to that world and to different ideas and perspectives outside of a traditional educational realm. And part of my job would be to protect the school, protect the faculty and students from traditional educational things, to keep Common Core and other educational concepts away from what we're doing so that we can really focus on real world issues and make meaningful impact.
Can you give some examples? What kind of approaches are you guys using here at Dalton Academy?
I mean, one example would be we have a space engineer from Canada working with us. And I think it's, you know, part of our job is, I mean, my job isn't just trying to protect our school and keep at bay these educational programs, but finding people from outside the education world and bringing them to China and bringing them to be part of the teaching and learning here. And so we do. We have a space engineer, this amazing guy, Jesse from Canada, who's working with our students. And now they look at physics, or a lot of the students look at physics in a completely different way. You know, and it could be designing satellites or looking at the orbits of planets and the energy from these planets and the mathematical equations that are involved in that kind of work. But space is something that's relevant. And space is something that we need to know about. And there's so many different fields and strands and jobs currently or will be in the future focused on space. And so for us, it's really important. And I think, and I would bet, and I would argue, we're the only school in the world with a space engineer. Which makes me think about the interest that we've had and why we actively sought to find someone with this background. Last year, we had a student who was teaching an aerospace engineering course. And hands down, that was the best class I've ever seen in this school. And this student was teaching other students about rocketry and aerospace engineering and the designs of rocket ships and comparing and contrasting different rocket ships from different countries, US and China and Russia. And it was so provocative and insightful. And this student was just on fire with their knowledge and skills, and there was the teaching instruction, but there was also very collaborative, and they're using different technologies to then design their own rockets. And I think that something that we do well here is giving people a platform to pursue their interests, and those students who really excel and have amazing knowledge and skills and are confident enough have an opportunity to even teach courses. And so that's something that we want to continue to foster and cultivate every year. Actually, we're working with the Global Online Academy, GOA, to provide a platform for our students to be teaching other students from around the world. Because people are shocked. People are shocked that the students can teach in our school and they're fully credited courses. So it's not just finding these outside amazing people to complement the teaching and learning at the school, but then also recognizing the talent that's here within our student population and also giving them that platform too.
How are you bringing these experts in? What is the incentive for them to give up their career in that field and just teach and be an educator?
It's not easy, I'm not gonna lie. But people can feel the passion that we have about the school, and that there's an opportunity here for people to make and create anything that they want. And there's no particular framework that they need to follow. And I think that's what's exciting. China's exciting right now. Beijing's exciting right now. And when people learn more about the school and this opportunity, they recognize that there's no other educational outfit or facility or community that exists like this. And so people for the first time are willing and wanting to come and work in a school because it's not like any other school. And so I think that people want to be a part of that, and they want to help to push things to another limit and to see what's possible.
Can you tell us about this lab within the lab concept?
The Affiliated High School Peking University is a school that we're a part of, but that's a very large school. And although the teaching and learning within that institution is very provocative, if you compare it to other Fujian schools in China. So part of our role or initiative or purpose is to be a lab within the lab doing even more provocative things because we're a small program. The ceiling of student enrollment is 300 and our faculty and staff is approximately 75. And I lump them together because what's different than most schools is that we want our non-teaching faculty part of the conversation dialogue with teaching and learning, and we don't separate them because their input is just as important as someone who's actually teaching in the face-to-face. And so being a lab school within a lab school allows us, or I guess there's that encouragement and or pressure for us to keep pushing the envelope and not resting. We recognize that this is a marathon that we're in, but there's no finish line, that we have to keep pushing each day, the teaching and learning, sharing the results, where have we stumbled, where have we found challenges. And the Affiliated High School Peking University is there to learn from us, from this model, and where we've seen strength and growth, and it's been sustainable, then it's something that they will implement within their own institution. And so we're leading the way, not only for those around the world, but for our very close family member, the Affiliated High School Peking University. So it's an amazing opportunity, I mean, to really help transform education. And the board chair and the principal, Wang Jian, who's in charge of the Affiliated High School Peking University, he's known around the world for transforming education or leading educational reform in China. And this is his baby, in a sense, that he wants to just take a lot of risks. And he wants us to fail forward and to sort of not give up this initiative, because in the end, he wants and expects that it's this provocative education that's going to really improve China and the rest of the world.
Thank you so much, Spencer, for your time.
Thank you so much for having me.
Speaking of innovative teaching and learning methods, let's go hear the voice of a student here at Dalton Academy. She's a student and she also teaches her own class. Hello, Jennifer, nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you too.
Jennifer, I know you're a student here from Dalton Academy. Can you tell us a little bit about yourself?
My Chinese name is Sihan and my English name is Jennifer, as you might know. And I'm a senior, so I've been here for 3 years, and I'm interested in psychology, and yeah, that's like the short information about me.
I've heard that you taught a class. Can you share that experience with us?
So I'm teaching a course on depression, because I Like I told you before that I like psychology. And so personally, I took an online course before I started this class. I actually took like two online courses, one on depression, the other on psychological first aid. And I also like read some articles about depression because I have like realized before that it's sort of like a big issue. And even it might be an issue in the school. So I felt like I needed to teach people about what it is. And so I put together this course using like multiple materials that I've written myself. And so it's a semester long course and I'm doing like as diverse as I can. The week before last, I tried a seminar and we discussed like the gender differences between men and women, like in the case of depression, like why is it that their like incidents at different ages are different, and like physiological differences and like social differences, and like it went pretty well. Like was a pretty big surprise to me because we were a very small class and people are not like always active, but the seminar was pretty nice. Like people kept talking for a while and I didn't really intervene a lot. And like last time we did a theme about like how media portray this kind of disease. So I selected some random short films or videos about depression online and showed them in class. And we sort of critiqued it and like commented it, like how does it like reflect depression? Is it scientific? And like, is it portrayed like well enough? And after that, we sort of like asked the students to create their own script about like short film about depression. So I'm doing a lot of experiments with it and it has like been going smoothly so far.
I know that classes here are, you book your own classes, right? You do your own schedules.
Yes.
Can you share like how's your day like on a daily basis here at Delta Academy?
It can vary a lot through the week. I have 5 classes on Monday, but I have only 2 classes, 3 classes today. And so so for Monday, I just like travel around classrooms the whole entire day. But today I have like 2 hours or so of free time. So I just like find a space in the school and like do random work.
What do you think of this new education system? What does it mean to you as a student here? And what do you think it means to your peers?
I think like the most straightforward thing is that it means flexibility. And that's something I really like. Because in other schools, the schedules and everything, the curriculum are pretty standardized. Everybody studies the same thing. So, but here, you get to choose what you want. And sort of like in that process, you will like discover what you want to do. And like, and after you've discovered that, you can sort of cultivate yourself based on what you realized. So I discovered that I wanted to like study psychology. So I chose more social science classes and I like took less physics classes, but in other schools I might have to continue to like doing that for a while, and that's something I really appreciate.
And what's your next step from here?
Probably college, and like I'm planning to like major in psychology and maybe double major in education, if not minor. And and I hope to like start a career after college focused on psychology or education.
Good luck with that. Thank you for talking to us, Jennifer.
Thank you.
After speaking with Spencer and Jennifer, we can clearly see that there's a group of passionate people who is driving great change in education, and it's happening in Beijing, China. That's the end of our show. We'll see you next time here on Crossover.